How's it going, everybody? My name is Brian Murphy. I'm 43 years old and I'm from Pennsylvania. I wanted to make this video to try to help families of people that are suffering from addiction, hopefully, navigate through the bullshit and kind of give people an idea of what they may expect. Of course, everybody's different. I'm in no way any type of psychiatrist, or I'm not a doctor or addiction specialist or anything like that. I have experienced firsthand addiction. I was a heroin addict and I was my life was completely unmanageable for most of my life. I was put on methadone when I was 17 years old, and I've been to numerous rehabs and detoxes and inpatient and outpatient and and all of that type of stuff. And I've been clean for approximately 15 years now. I wanted to just kind of go through the cycle of what a lot of people experience. And, just like I said before, just hopefully somebody could get something out of this and, it may help someone out there. But what basically happens in a lot of cases is somebody, maybe your son or daughter, or may end up, for whatever reason, sometimes people get in a car accident and they end up taking some type of opioid painkillers like Percocet or Oxycontin or anything like that. This happens to children, this happens to senior citizens, it happens to everybody, because a lot of people don't understand the physical aspect of it. And we live in a society that makes that turns everything into a situation to where someone's character is the reason for why they have not to say that people don't make bad decisions, and yes, in some cases, people's characters are what causes the situation. But in a lot of cases, you have people that are in accidents or for whatever reason, take small dosage of opioid painkillers, and it only takes a couple of weeks. That's really all it takes. You could take a very small dosage of something like Percocet or something of that nature for a couple of weeks, and then you turn around and your prescription runs out, and you begin to feel very uncomfortable. You can't sleep, irritable, depressed, and you start to experience, minor withdrawal symptoms. And in some cases, people are able to back out at that point and be able to escape something like that, but for a lot of people, that's not the case. And for a lot of people, they either have chronic pain, realistically, or they may just, continue. They may be in a part of their life where they're suffering for whatever reason, a breakup, or they're depressed over whatever it is, and they may end up continuing to use these painkillers. A lot of times this happens and people will continue to use the painkillers until a point where it becomes unmanageable. And when it becomes unmanageable is when they can no longer get prescriptions or whatever the case may be, and they start to have to purchase these opioid painkillers in other places, illegally, usually on the streets. And what happens is the price of them becomes excessive to where they can no longer pay their bills and it begins to take over their lives, they at that point will try to make an effort to get off of them. In some cases, they can, in some cases they can't. Obviously, I can't speak for everybody, but what happens is you end up, you're now addicted to an opiate, which means that your body needs this in order to feel what would be considered normal for any normal person would be considered normal, have a normal sleep habit, a normal, appetite, just feeling of well-being. So at that point, people have two options. You could go to a detox, or you could continue to buy these drugs on the street and continue to do what you're doing. What happens is the price of heroin ends up being cheaper than the price of buying one pill for $20 or for $40. Somebody can buy one bag of heroin for $10 and they can get just as high, if not higher. So it ends up helping them to continue in this direction that they're going in. So that's why you see so many people starting with the opiate painkillers and then ending up on heroin. When people do go to a detox, we end up seeing what happens is someone goes into a detox. At that point, they will generally use something like Suboxone or methadone to help the person get through this period of time physically so that they can get their body, the physical addiction, they could get through the physical addiction without suffering very much, because most people would not be able to go through that without any help like that. It's very uncommon for someone to do that. If it was that easy, people would just do it. Obviously, people don't want to ruin their lives. It's not a conscious decision to ruin their lives. My point is that you have a physical situation going on there. So someone goes into a detox, they take Suboxone, methadone, for approximately a week to 10 days. It gets the person off of whatever pills or, short-acting opiate they're using. So just to give you a brief understanding on what that is, a short-acting opiate would be something like heroin or something like Percocet. And what that means is that it comes out of your system faster. It does whatever it does, and then it comes out of your system. A long-acting one would be something more like methadone, which is meant for more of a maintenance type scenario where it goes into your system and it has a half-life to it. So what happens is the length of time that it is inside of your body is a lot longer, which means it is a lot more difficult to get off in the end. But when it's used in a detox scenario, it's only used for a short period of time. You're only using it for 7 to 10 days. It gets the person off of whatever it is that they're using. And in that scenario, it works fairly well. It helps the person get through the physical portion so that they can deal with whatever emotional issues were going on that may have led to whatever it is that they were doing. A lot of people come out and try to go to meetings. They'll try to go to meetings. They'll try to go to outpatient programs and stuff of that nature. A lot of the times, they end up relapsing. Either having to being lucky enough to have to go back to a detox, and in a lot of cases when people relapse, they end up even worse, really hurting themselves really bad, and in some cases actually overdosing and dying because they end up going back to taking the same dosages that they had taken previous to being clean after they had clean. So their body is not used to whatever it is that they were doing, and then that's what ends up happening. But in a nutshell, people in most cases, and they will even tell you this in these rehabs, that most people will not succeed at cleaning themselves up. They will come out of detox, continue to do their meetings. Some people will do great for a month or two, some people do great for a week or two. And so it really depends on the individual and, you know, how severe their addiction is. A lot of times, the depression from going through this, which is a real, this is not, a, this is where there, you're going to have disagreements where some people that may never have gone through that may tell you one thing, where someone that has, it really depends. There's a lot of chemical, to give you the basic idea on what happens in the brain is you have a normal brain, just let's just say on this side, has 15 receptors. And we have in our brains a chemical called dopamine. A normal person, that dopamine attaches to the receptor site and it makes someone have a feeling of well-being. If you start to, when you have sex, if you eat chocolate, if you eat ice cream, stuff like that, you will get a rush of dopamine, and that is what would make you feel even more, you know, more of a feeling of euphoria and all of this. What happens is when somebody starts to use opiates, or a lot of drugs in many cases, but we're talking about opiates here, but when someone uses opiates, the opiates flood the receptor site. The receptor site, in turn, excuse me, begins to grow additional receptors so that it can compensate for this flood of dopamine. That is why someone feels so good when they're high off of these drugs. The problem is that when that dopamine rush goes away through detox or whatever the case may be, you still have X amount of dopamine receptors, but you don't, your brain is now not capable of filling them receptors and making you feel normal. So this is the issue. This is the physical issue that is going on. So when someone, and again, someone that has only been doing drugs for a short amount of time, their brain will bounce back a lot quicker. Someone that has not is obviously, it's going to be more of, it's going to be a longer, harder road for them to regain some type of balance there. But a lot of times people go into the rehab, they come out, go into the detox, they come out. They do good for a little while, and then it starts to creep up on them. They're not, you know, really feeling that great, and they end up relapsing. So what happens is you have this, like, this repetitive, you know, over and over, you know, someone goes in, they come out, you're doing the same thing over and over. At that point, somebody has to make a decision as to what long term is going to be the best bet for this particular person in their scenario. That's where drugs like methadone and suboxone come in, because what methadone and suboxone is, like I said before, they're long-acting opiates. So it allows somebody to be maintained, what happens with Suboxone is them receptor sites, the drug clings to the receptor site and tricks the receptor site into believing that it is okay. It believes that it is the dopamine, it's getting what it needs. It's just like a plug in an outlet. It's clinging to the receptor site. And in many cases, some Suboxones will actually block other opioids. So if an opioid comes in and tries to hit that receptor site, it's going to throw it off and cause the person to have withdrawal symptoms, which, you know, and for someone that's trying to get off drugs, that is a good thing, if you ask me. So basically, you have two choices. You could continue to keep going to detoxes, go in a detox, come out, do good for 2-3 weeks, shoot dope again, risk dying because your body's not used to it, or you can try to take a long-term something that is a maintenance, which I believe is the best option only for somebody that has attempted numerous times to get clean, has gotten clean, and that has ended up just relapsing again. Because what it allows someone to do is, if someone takes a maintenance drug like that, it will allow them to be able to deal with life and learn how to live again. You have to understand, somebody that's under suffering addiction, every waking hour of every single day is 100% focused on the drug, how to get the drug. What you don't know how to enjoy anything in your life anymore. It's not about wanting to fail the people in your family or wanting to hurt the people in your family. You do not have a choice. There is a physical scenario going on in your body that is, when you put that chemical in your body, is altering your brain, causing you to. So that's why I tell people, you cannot take it personal. You cannot think that someone doesn't love you, or it's past that. It's way past. We're talking about a physical situation going on. Yes, there's emotional, and yes, there is, you have varying degrees in everything. But the bottom line is, if you give someone a long-term, something like methadone or Suboxone, it will allow the person to learn how to live again, to learn to find themselves again, and start to navigate through life again and be able to get grounded and learn how to be able to enjoy other things in life and not be 100% focused on doing drugs. The bad part of that is, like I mentioned before, when you take a long-acting opiate, it's harder to get off of it. So, like I said, I'm talking about, this is the worst case scenario. If you have someone in your family that is in and out of detoxes and you have tried everything and there's no other options, that is something that could potentially work. For me, it worked because it allowed me to, like I said before, to learn how to live again. At that point, when someone learns how to live again and starts to find other things in their life that they can appreciate and that they can enjoy, that's when you begin to slowly take them off of the long-acting maintenance drugs. Sometimes people end up having to take it. It's the lesser of two evils. The same way as someone having any other physical ailment that they need to take a drug for. We live in a society where it is known to be a fact, a scientific fact, that your dopamine receptors are being altered, but yet they will say that your character is flawed because you are not able to get your life in order. So it's like on one hand they're saying, okay, we have proof that there's a physical situation going on, but yet you're a failure for not being able to get clean because you see what I'm getting at? It's very, very confusing scenario going on there. But that's it in a nutshell. I mean, I wish I had a magic answer to tell people. I know that it's a very scary thing, especially if you have a child that any loved one that's suffering through this, and you just feel like you've lost them, the person they were. But in reality, as in my opinion, from this has affected my life. I've lived it every day since I was approximately 17 years old. I'm 43. I've been clean for 15 years. I went from being homeless and living in a homeless shelter without 2 cents in my pocket to having a beautiful home and a beautiful business, and my life is manageable again. That is the route that I personally took to get my, because I went to numerous rehabs and numerous detoxes and failed and failed and failed and failed. I even brought drugs into the detoxes. That's how deeply whacked out my brain was during that period of time. In and out of jail numerous times. Like I said, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a psychiatrist, but I can tell you firsthand from losing friends in my life to drug addiction and being around it, that is basically what you got. You got detox, you got NA, which is a great mental support system, moral support system, and there's great people there. It can really help somebody. But sometimes that's not enough for some people, and they continue to relapse. And what I'm saying is, I rather see somebody have to take something to get their life back in order than run the risk of shooting a bunch of bags of dope and dying because their body's not even used to what they're doing. Some people may disagree with that, depending on what they've been through, but I just wanted to share what I've personally been through, and that's what I feel is the best way to do it. You give it the best try you can, do everything you can to get off of it. Use whatever support systems you have. But in the end, if you continue to fail and continue to fail and continue to fail, there's a reason why this is happening. It's happening because your brain, in many cases, has been altered. And sometimes in some cases, you may have to take something to keep that balance so that you can live a normal life. So I'm gonna leave it at that for now. If anybody has any questions or anything like that, feel free to leave a comment, and I'll do the best I can to to help you out. Or if you see anything, if there's anything that you wanted to ask me or wanted me to make a video about, I can do that too to try to help some people out. Learning how to deal with people that have come out of rehabs and, a lot of cases, people end up being worse for the person by supporting They call it loving someone to death, you know, where you continue to be there, continue to support someone, and you're basically allowing them to kill themselves. And I know that's a very touchy subject, but you know, if you want to talk about that in the next video, we could do that. I'd like to try to help out whoever I can at this point. And that's about it. Happy New Year to everybody, and best of health to you guys. All right, have a good night.